I really don't want to do this. I really don't. But I guess I'm going to have to do this. So, sup, Trophy Hunters. KingSuperOne has just signed it. And welcome to my first reaction video about StayPationt. I guess his name is StayPationt, but I guess his name is StayPationt, but StayPationt. What kind of name is that? Seriously? So you gave me a shout out, thank you so much, but there's one thing I want to see in you. So what you people don't understand is the way I review people is that I want to see people who actually plays games, not being a trophy hunter. So what I'm trying to say is, do you actually play games? Actually play games for fun to the point where you want to collect all the trophies to 100%? Or you're just one of those people who want to play kids games and just get like 50 fucking platinums because you fucking think you're badass. The only thing I know is that he's going to review the guy and I want to see how he reviews him. So this is going to be the first time I'm going to be reacting to this. The only thing I can say right now is that please be a good one. All right, let's get this started.
Hey guys, StayPationt here, back to review another subscriber's trophy collection. Now I'd like to reiterate that if you want to put your name down for this series and have your own account reviewed, you can do so by messaging me
privately. Son of a fucking bitch, give me one second. Alright, my dumbass self forgot the headphones, so here we go, let's do this again.
This series and have your own account reviewed, you can do so by messaging me privately. Now to do that, if you come to my channel page and click the About tab, this will take you to a screen with the option to send me a message. Now, please don't abuse this and send me every single question that pops into your head, but obviously, if you leave a comment asking for a review, then it's likely to get missed. But if you contact me directly, then I've got a record of your request and, you know, make sure to put your PSN ID and everything, and I will add you to that list.
It is quite a long one, though,
so I have provided you with the option if you wish. You know, if you're particularly keen about having a review done, you can sign up on Patreon, and one of the rewards on here does involve priority on the list. So I have a list of Patreon subscribers I'm going to work through.
Be a star of sub trophy collection review video. You had to fucking pay him $6 for that shit? What the fuck is that? Are you fucking serious? Nah, don't do that shit. Bro, when I review people, I do that shit free. Why the fuck are you gonna pay people $6 for that? Nah, dude, that's fucked up. I don't fuck with that right now.
First, and then that's something I don't like about you right now. Of you guys. Now, I only recommend signing up on Patreon if you want to support the channel anyway. This is just one of the ways in which I thank those guys who do want to support me. And there are plenty of other rewards you'll be receiving as well. So if they appeal to you too, then it might be worth signing up. And along with those rewards, you'll just be bumped up to closer to the top of the list. But I have increased the regularity of this show because I want to make sure that it's not just for the Patreon subscribers. I would like to get to the rest of you as well. So I'm going to do my best to try and do one of these every week. Now today, we're actually going to be reviewing the account belonging to one of our non-Patreon subscribers. And that's because Lucas, who many of you will recognize from the comment sections, he actually came up with this idea in the first place. It wasn't his idea so much, but he saw it on another channel and he suggested it to me. And of course, I'm taking a bit of a different angle to the channel that's already doing this.
Ty doesn't like me.
But just to prove to you guys my integrity as a YouTuber, because recently, obviously, there's been some people kind of trolling my account, disliking my videos as soon as they're uploaded and things like that. And some of you have suggested that sometimes YouTube channels do that to other similar channels, trying to kind of squash them and have a negative impact on them. But I think that's crazy. I think, you know, we should all work as a community. Other channels that are similar to yours help to boost your own channel. But
yeah, we can work as a community. Here's the problem. I'm not a negative guy. I want to see how you review. So let's see.
It kind of increases awareness and increases interest in the subject that you're covering. So I'm going to give a shout out to KingSuperOne, who is the guy who was doing this series before me. And Lucas was watching those videos and enjoyed them and suggested the idea to me. So I'm taking a bit of a different angle. I think he sort of reviews accounts in the sense of actually scoring them and giving them a rating, as it were.
Sadly.
I personally couldn't do that because I could never sort of say anything negative about anyone. I'm not that kind of person. I think it's an interesting approach. But personally, I just have a look and sort of look through someone's trophy journey and sort of try and figure out what we can about them as a gamer and as a person. but okay. I'm literally going to put a link to KingSuperOne's channel at the end of the video, because obviously without his idea in the first place, then this series wouldn't exist, and I think everyone deserves praise where it's due, so go and check out his channel. It's a relatively small channel. I consider myself to be a small channel, and he's smaller than I am, so
it would
be
great
if we can send some subs his way. And it'd be interesting because he's not expecting this. I've never spoken to him. I haven't told him that I'm going to do this. It'd be quite interesting to see if we can send a bunch of subs his way.
Reaction video, man.
Surprise him. And maybe you can leave a comment on one of his videos saying that Stay Patient sent you.
I only got one guy.
Just figured that if you guys are watching this series and you enjoy it, then you probably enjoy the series that he's running as well. Anyway, let's dive into this review. This is YORDAVIN. As I mentioned, it's Lucas.
Oh, okay, sorry. Shout out to YORDAVIN for, I guess, suggesting it to him, for giving him a shout out to me. So, if you ever want me to review you, let me know. I'll probably do it ASAP. Well, actually, you know what? If I'm looking at this list, I want to see what this guy says. I keep forgetting I said that shit.
Come on. And he's been kind of waiting for a review for a while. You see, just before I made a Patreon reward, he was going to be the next on the list, and I'd forgotten about that, so I felt quite bad because he was sort of working
one
hard
fucking
on preparing
hour.
His trophy on. Collection. To-
I forgot. This is a fucking hour video. Like, I do it in fucking 30 minutes. This guy does it in an hour. I had to see this.
Be reviewed. So we're going to go back and do him, mostly, you know, because he was the guy who came up with the idea in the first place. Anyway, he's got a bit of a smaller collection when compared to the previous two accounts. If you guys are watching this series and you enjoy it, then you probably enjoy the series that he's running as well. Anyway, let's dive into this review. This is YORDAVIN. As I mentioned, it's Lucas. And he's been kind of waiting for a review for a while. You see, just before I made it a Patreon reward, he was going to be the next on the list, and I'd forgotten about that, so I felt quite bad.
No disrespect, but I want to see this shit.
Preparing his trophy collection to be reviewed. So we're going to go back and do him, mostly, you know, because he was the guy who came up with the idea in the first place. Anyway, he's got a bit of a smaller collection when compared to the previous two accounts that we reviewed.
The
obviously,
hell?
Darren's was a large collection. It was a low completion percentage, but he had a lot of games, hundreds of games played on.
Did he just, like, repeat his fucking...
There, and a decent number of platinums as well. As always, though, I've asked Lucas to give us a bit of a statement. So we're going to read this through quickly.
Oh my fucking God!
To be honest, it took me some time to find out what trophies were about. I finally noticed them while playing my favourite game ever, Fallout New Vegas, and that was a point of no return. A platinum makes me feel that I squeeze a game of all its content. It gives me a great sense of accomplishment, and I really enjoy the challenge, which is why I don't generally like easy platinums, unless they're from good games.
I fuck with them.
Finally, it offers an overall goal and makes a game much more fun to play. Oh, and to hear a platinum pop and to see a game at 100% pure
fuck with this guy. Fuck with this guy.
So, with Lucas, I get the idea that it's not about reaching a high level or earning a lot of platinums. It's all about his experience with each individual game. And
that's what it's all about, basically.
You know, he's got a lot of long...
It's funny, because that's what it's all about. But when you reach the point where you get quantity platinum, man, fuck me.
Games on there that, you know, would have taken him a long time to get through, a lot of RPGs and things like that. So he's poured his time in, and he enjoys really getting everything out of those games. So when he does earn that one platinum, that's a real sense of accomplishment for him. Of course, some of us play a lot of easy platinums along with the harder ones and sort of whack them on the account to build up our level, but you never really get the same sense of accomplishment with them. They're useful in the sense that they can boost your level,
okay,
and then the hard platinums
we
that
get
you've
it.
Earned are more noticeable to other people because, you know, you're a high level, so more people take a look at your account. But like we say, you know, they're not as satisfying as the games that take a while and the games that you really pour yourself into, especially if you play the game for longer than you need to for the platinum. Now, Lucas mentions there his favourite game ever, which all of us are probably aware of because he's spoken about it a few times. That's Fallout New Vegas. Now, my favourite game of all time is Fallout 3, so we share a very similar taste there. And with these types of games, you know, for me personally, I pour myself into a Fallout game. I never approach it with trophies on my mind. Mm-hmm. I do know what the trophies are, and I make sure that I'm aware of any missable ones and things like that.
Okay,
but I think
we get it.
There's an example of games that you could steamroll through and just make a beeline for all the missions and all the quests that need to be done for trophies and get through it pretty quickly. And you'd get a sense of accomplishment, but not quite in the same way as if you really pour yourself into the game and complete everything you can, every quest you come across, whether it's trophy related or not. And then when you finally earn a platinum on a game that you've spent maybe hundreds of hours playing, that's even more satisfying. Not because you've had to do anything different, but just because it's more of a kind of a memory for you. it almost like represents a period in your life as a gamer. You look at that platinum and it brings back all these memories of the time that you spent playing that game.
Okay, so like, yeah, like when I played Final Fantasy 13, I fucking had to do those goddamn fucking turtles. Yeah, I know. Come on, man.
Sort of feeling that Lucas gets here. I think he really pours himself into these RPGs and longer titles so that when he earns a platinum, it's not about earning a lot of platinums, but it's about
what each individual platinum means to him. Hold on. This is a short list for 56 fucking minutes? Okay, dude.
On a personal level. So the first thing we're going to just mention here is the fact that he does have some missing timestamps. Now, I know a lot of you are going to jump on that and say, oh, he's hacked. Like, that's not the case.
No. Yeah. Bruh. Oh my fucking god. That's literally... I remember when I interviewed somebody. No. I remember when I reviewed somebody. I literally fucking thought that guy was a hacker. And just like what he just said. Wow.
He did explain to me why this is, and it makes total sense. And to be honest...
And look, if those motherfuckers whoever watched that video bitch about me with the time says, man, I apologize, okay? Next time, when I review somebody, I'll be better, okay? So don't bitch. If you don't think I'm a good reviewer, you can get someone else to do it. Or this guy, even though he's taking a brick.
When you hack trophies, it doesn't usually come back with missing timestamps. Usually, you know, the hacker will put timestamps, and if they're a good hacker, they'll try and spread them out and put them in the correct order. But most hackers don't do a very good job, and the reason it's detectable isn't because the timestamps are missing.
Why are you explaining shit?
Because they are too close together, or they're in the wrong order, or whatever. So with these, what's happened basically is when Lucas bought a PS3, he didn't set up an account to begin with. He didn't set up a PSN account, he didn't connect to the internet, and he didn't set the time and date. So his PS3 didn't actually have a time and date set to be able to match to the trophies. Now you notice that he only really started playing on PS3 around sort of 2013, depending on how long he'd been playing Fallout New Vegas before that. So he's not been on PlayStation very long. I did ask him about his gaming history, and he has been a gamer for 30 odd years, so he's very experienced, but not so much with PlayStation. He never had a PS1 or a PS2, and as you can see, he was quite a late adopter to the PS3. In fact, he bought a PS3, from the looks of it, the year that the PS4 came out. Now, as he mentioned, Fallout New Vegas is the game that got him into trophies. He was playing this, and he sort of noticed that the trophies were popping, and because he loved the game so much, he sort of took a look at the trophy list and figured out what he had left to do, just to try and squeeze everything out of the game that he could. Now, I did have a look at his trophies in order of when he earned them, but because of the missing timestamps, it just kind of alternates Fallout New Vegas with Dragon Age Origins and puts them near the start. So it'd be quite interesting to hear from you, Lucas, maybe in the comments, you know, whether Fallout New Vegas was the first game you played on PlayStation. Because as you said,
why does that matter?
You became aware of what trophies were. So I'm not sure whether maybe Fallout New Vegas...
I'm not trying to be messed up, but like... Why do you care what game he plays first for PlayStation?
It was the game you were playing, and it took you a while you were playing that to understand trophies. Or maybe...
I mean, I guess that's something cool, but like...
There was a bunch of games you played before that. But I do know that Lucas, you know, although he's new to PlayStation, he has had a lot of other consoles, and he was also playing on PC. That was his main platform at the time, so he was probably well aware of the Fallout games before buying the PS3. One thing that's interesting, and that I'd also like to hear back from you about, Lucas, is which of the Fallout games you played first? Because I'm a firm believer of, you know, the first game you play in a series is often your favorite, or the first game you play from a developer, things like that. Now,
are you, like, heavily interested in this?
As I mentioned, it's my favorite game of all time. It's mostly because of my personal circumstances when I played it. And it was the fact that it was my first proper Western RPG, sort of action shooter RPG. Now, I played Fallout 3 before New Vegas. I love New Vegas, even though it didn't review as well as Fallout 3. But it was never going to topple Fallout 3 as my favorite game because I kind of already knew what to expect going in. So it wasn't as...
Wait, he said he played Fallout 3 before New Vegas. Didn't 3 came out first?
...much of a surprise. That first moment when you first experience, you know, heading out into the wasteland, especially on Fallout 3 where you leave the vault, you know, everything's quite closed in and you don't really know what to expect unless you've seen like videos of it or whatever. But when you step outside that vault for the first time, and it's the first time Fallout had been sort of 3D and everything, you know, step outside and you see this massive sprawling open world in front of you and sort of imagine all the possibilities, all the people you're going to meet and everything, that experience is unforgettable. And that's why, you know, that's one of the things that contributed to Fallout 3 being my favorite game. So I'd be interested in hearing which of the Fallouts you played first obviously based on the timestamps, I'm guessing that it's Fallout New Vegas, and that would explain why New Vegas is your favorite, why you prefer it to Fallout 3, why it's your favorite game of all time, because our first experience with a franchise is often more memorable, especially if it's been sort of rebooted or brought up to date like Fallout was at the time. I think the same applies when you look at Fallout versus The Elder Scrolls, you know? If The Elder Scrolls was the first franchise you played from Bethesda when it comes to their big RPGs, then quite often that becomes your favorite because their open worlds are just so fascinating.
I mean, you do not see Skyrim right there?
That when you play one of their games for the first time, it really sticks with you. So I'm a firm believer of the idea that whichever one you play first is often your favorite. That's not true for everybody, of course. But I think that's probably what's happened here. New Vegas is his favorite game of all time, but he loves Fallout 3 as well. As you can see, he played it straight after by the looks of things, depending on the timestamps.
Okay, and, we get the timestamps. We get
franchise.
It.
And later on, we see that he did go ahead and play Fallout 4 as well. In fact, I think Fallout 4 is an even better example of what we were mentioning earlier about how you can go into a game and just make a beeline for the trophies and, you know, have a sense of accomplishment about it. But you can also play a game to death, you know, you can really rinse it of content, as it were. You know, most of the missions and quests in Fallout 3 are required for trophies. There aren't a huge number of quests, but they are very fleshed out, you know? They are big quests, they're big side quests that feel like story quests in other games.
This motherfucker's gonna explain everything about Fallout 3 and New Vegas.
Games, you know? So, if you pretty much 100% of Fallout 3, then you're going to be earning most of the trophies. But when it comes to Fallout 4, there's a lot of stuff you don't need to do for trophies. In fact, most of the trophies that are quest-related refer to the story quests because you've got the different sort of endings. So you've got multiple story quests branching off to reach all four different endings. So when it comes to Fallout 4, you get that even greater sense of accomplishment if you really spent a lot of time playing everything and maybe didn't even look at the trophies. You just kind of saw...
Bro, if you get all fucking Fallouts, you're badass.
There was branching endings, so you're like, right, I'll make a save at some point and I'll do those endings. But if you really spend a lot of time trying to do everything in the game, doing every quest you come across, and then when that trophy pops, when the platinum unlocks, that just gives you a real sense of satisfaction because you've earned it through just playing the game. Rather than sort of trying for the trophies, you've earned it because you love the game and you've been rewarded for the amount of effort and the amount of time that you've put into it. Dragon Age Origins is obviously another RPG. I've never actually played this series at all, but I know they're really well regarded. Obviously, a lot of time has gone into this. We don't know exactly how long with the missing timestamp. Same goes for Final Fantasy 13, actually.
Oh my god.
This is a game that... I played on my old account, and it was around the time when I was sort of making a transition to a new account or considering the possibility of doing so.
Like, really so need to know your history?
And fully 100%ed it. I do know that it's quite an undertaking, though. It is a long one, and that's one of the reasons I didn't 100% it while I was playing it. I just kind of played through. I was focused on the trophies, but then there was a lot of stuff I had to go back and do. So it's really time-consuming, this one. And a lot of people don't enjoy the Final Fantasy 13 series, you know, 13, 13.2, then you've got Lightning Returns, of course. And I do agree that they're, you know, they're not as good. The stories and everything, the combat, is not as good as your typical Final Fantasy games. But I think 13 was an okay game, you know, I quite enjoyed
it. Sucks ass, fuck that.
It was probably better than the follow-ups. So, you know, I'll be interested in seeing how much fun you had with this. I don't actually see any other Final Fantasy games on the list. I may be mistaken, but maybe his experience with Final Fantasy 13.
Bruh, put your shit in ABC order.
Put him off playing any of the others, but you know, that might be the case. He hasn't played 15 yet. Obviously, you've got Final Fantasy 10, which is available on PS3.
He hasn't played 15 yet. Dude, I see PS3 so far. I don't see any PS4.
PS3, Vita, and PS4 as a shared trophy list. That, in my personal opinion, is probably my favorite Final Fantasy, or at least one of them. So maybe you didn't quite enjoy the franchise enough to want to go back and play any of the others.
I mean, when you play 13 the first time, no shit. It's a long one.
Skyrim, again, this is another long trophy set.
I'm sorry, if you played if Final Fantasy 13 is your first Final Fantasy, oh my fucking god, dude. Like, damn. You gotta play 7? No, fuck that. 6. Well, maybe 7, yeah. Play 7. 10? Man, those are 10 times better. 13, you play 13 the first time, bruh. Oh, man. You play 10, you'd be like, why the fuck did I play 13? Definitely.
He's only played it on PS3, but that kind of plays into his philosophy of playing games that he enjoys and really pouring his time into it, so he gets that sense of accomplishment,
I fuck with that.
Popping the platinum. He's not the kind of person who goes back and plays a game again on another console, unless maybe really loves it. I'm wondering, actually, I'd be interested in hearing if you would play a Fallout New Vegas remaster if it did come out on PS4. That's something that I'd really love. A lot of you guys have mentioned that on the channel as well. I think Fallout 3 and New Vegas are ripe for remastering because they just
perform so poorly. You're going back to the Fallout shit. Come on, man. On the
PS3. They're just too big. There's too much to them. And the PS3 just can't handle them, so they're made for PS4 really. These two on PS4 to like update them, even if they didn't really remaster the graphics a massive amount, if they just put it on the PS4 so that it could be played without crashing constantly, without freezing, the frame rates dropping, then that would be amazing, and I'd definitely replay both of them. But like I say, I'd love to hear if Fallout New Vegas might be the first game, if it does come out on PS4. Might be the first game that you would be willing to replay a second time. So we've jumped ahead a fair bit here. We're up at 2015 now. He started off in 2013, but obviously these are long games. I get the impression he's not in any rush to finish the games. Like we mentioned before, he's trying to get everything from them. And maybe he doesn't have a huge amount of time for gaming anyway. So he's sort of taking his time with these big RPGs, really getting his money's worth, which I think is the best way of experiencing them. Borderlands 2, I love that he's played this. Most of you will know is, you know, among my favorite games of all time. I think it's absolutely brilliant.
And he has PS4, okay.
I saw a video recently talking about Borderlands 3. Some of you may have seen this. It was during GDC, I think it was. And they were talking through their sort of graphical engine. They've created a new engine. I'm not going to go into it in depth. Obviously, you guys can check out the video if you're interested. But just the fact that they're now talking about Borderlands 3, leaked that it existed. Obviously, a lot of people were questioning it. We weren't sure whether there was going to be another one. It made sense that there would be. But a while ago, a few years ago, one of the main guys at Gearbox actually said that he was a bit concerned, a bit worried about making another Borderlands because he knew that the expectations for it would be so high. And he felt like maybe they wouldn't be able to do everyone's expectations justice. He said that he wasn't sure what direction they should take, you know, what kind of game it should be and how they could bring it into the next generation. Now, that really kind of filled me with confidence at the fact that, you know, they weren't just cashing in. They weren't like, right, let's just make another Borderlands 2 and call it Borderlands 3 with new areas and stuff. They were really worried about making the best game they possibly could to please the fans.
Yeah, right. And that's why it's taken a long time to come around from Alien fucking Call Marines.
Borderlands 3. Obviously, Borderlands 2 came out in 2011, I think, so it's been 6 years already, nearly. Obviously, we had the pre-sequel, which was a different... ...development studio. But Gearbox themselves haven't made a Borderlands game for 6 years, and it's going to be a long time yet, because they're only just now talking about the very basics of the engine that they're creating. So okay. I'm really excited for this because the fact that they have held off, the fact that they were concerned about making the game right, that really bodes well. I'm super, super excited. I'm just really happy that they are now, you know, at the point where they're happy talking about it.
Enough about the future games. Let's talk about the trophies, please.
Even if it is just related to the engine itself. Anyway, we're getting a bit sidetracked with my love of Borderlands there. He's played The Walking Dead.
Okay.
But as he mentioned in his comment, he said he doesn't really like easy games because they don't give him a sense of accomplishment. And that's totally fair enough, of course.
I'm sorry, but The Walking Dead is game of the year. So even if it's easy as shit, that's a game you're supposed to enjoy. That's one of the games I really would love to play if I ever get a chance.
He said he'll only play an easy game if it's a fun title, if it's something enjoyable.
It should be enjoyable.
So The Walking Dead is definitely an example of that. The story's great. I really enjoyed the first season and the second one, really. And he's gone ahead and played that, but he's definitely not played it just for the trophies because he doesn't have, from one other one, he doesn't have many of the Telltale games on his list.
Okay.
And he hasn't gone back and replayed it on PS4 or PS Vita to stack the trophies.
Okay.
This is very much a reflection of Lucas as a gamer. Rather than just being games that he has played for the trophies, this is really the games that we know he wanted to play, the ones he enjoyed, the ones that kind of represent his preference, his taste when it comes to genres and franchises. And
okay, so basically he's a trophy hunter in a way that he's an actual real gamer. Well, right now I actually fuck with this guy, so...
And that's really nice. It's nice to have an account that is a true reflection of someone's gaming habits and gaming preferences. He's played the Lord of the Rings Conquest here. I'm guessing he's probably a fan of Lord of the Rings. You know, he's played Skyrim.
Oh, I just realized Conquest is there. Holy shit, universe. Dude.
He enjoys his open world RPGs we've seen.
No one lied
and
for
so
you,
he probably
man.
Tried this off the back of it being an RPG, and maybe he's a fan of Lord of the Rings anyway. That's and kind of the reason I played it.
I forgot PlayStation Home's right there, too. I think he fucked up with the server shit.
And he hasn't finished it, which is thoroughly understandable because it's not really a good game. It's very kind of... It's very basic, it's very dumbed down, it's almost like a kid's RPG, and yeah, it almost feels like one of those kind of platformers, like a PS2 sort of kids platforming hack and slash game. But you know, he could always go back and finish it if he's worried about it, but obviously this represents the fact that he didn't particularly enjoy it.
Have you even checked the online?
Obviously the LEGO games are great. I can't remember if this was free.
Okay, so he doesn't really check the online for it. I mean, he doesn't even check the trophies for Lord of the Rings. He just talks about... So basically, all you do is just talk about the games.
At some point. I think it might have been on Vita, but not PS3. But possibly it may have been. Maybe that's why he's played it, if it was free. But they're always enjoyable. Some people really love them, and they play every LEGO game.
I don't think he's played any other ones.
I played it. And he hasn't sort of kids platforming hack and slash game. But, you know, he could always go back and finish it if he's worried about it. But obviously this represents the fact that he didn't particularly enjoy it.
You didn't check it online.
LEGO Batman 2 here. Obviously the LEGO games are great. I can't remember if this was free at some point. I think it might have been on Vita, but not PS3. But possibly it may have been. Maybe that's why he's played it, if it was free. But they're always enjoyable. Some people really love them, and they play every LEGO game. I don't think he's played any other ones apart from this, but I think the first one you play is always fun, and then it kind of gets a bit samey. Diablo 3, this is a respectable platinum. Obviously, there's a real grind.
Diablo 3?
Involved with this one. I've not done it myself, but I know that it does take quite a while to get through one of the trophies in particular. I forget the name of it, but you guys who have played it will know. And this is... incidentally the first PS4 title he played, so it looks like he waited until 2015 to pick up the PS4. Maybe he realized that he was sort of running out of RPGs he was interested in playing on the PS3, and he wanted to pick
Why
up
are you
the
making
PS4
assumptions?
And play some of the RPGs like Diablo 3 and like some of the other games that
Dude,
show
that's
up
like unnecessary
this.
Assumptions
in fact, it's not even just RPGs, but it's sort of anything. Well, he likes his open world games. It also looks like he enjoys sort of strategy games or ones with a layer of difficulty. Let's see here, though. He's got SteamWorld Dig, XCOM Enemy Within. This is a good option for those of you who enjoy XCOM, which I do. I love the idea of the series, and I have spent some time with them. But Enemy Unknown was very, very difficult and extremely long-winded, Enemy Within is a bit quicker. It's still tricky, but it's not super difficult. So this might be the reason he's played it. Maybe he'd got so into trophies by this point that he thought to himself, you know what, there's XCOM Enemy Within and Enemy Unknown. They're both similar games. This one is actually more recent, so it's probably, you know, maybe a little bit better in some ways. Maybe the engine has been tweaked and or the mechanics of the game.
Okay,
the
isn't it basically DLC added in this shit?
Around what's required. You know, there's so much stuff going on. You've got to worry about the world map. You've got to worry about your research and everything. And you need to do everything right to be able to get the trophies. So maybe off the back of the time requirement and the fact that this was more recent and maybe a little bit easier, he's decided to play this. In fact, I looked at the trophy guide. You know, when I saw this on the list, I was reminding myself of how difficult it is. And I took a look and it's given a 6 out of 10. And that's actually kind of encouraged me to maybe try it out myself, because I feel like I just wouldn't have the time to dedicate to Enemy Unknown to be able to get that platinum, or maybe even XCOM 2. I would like to play it.
More like dedicate the time to play a fucking strategy game. I can't do that shit.
XCOM 2 at some point, I'll probably do it on a blank account. But like I say, this is probably...
But if y'all do the survey, I can do it.
The better option for trophy hunters if you do want to enjoy the XCOM experience. You do have XCOM the Bureau, whatever it's called. That's a very different game. That's like a third person kind of shooter, almost like strategy based shooter, almost like a Mass Effect. But I don't know, it didn't get as good reviews, and obviously it's a very different style of game. It's not top down strategy, so that might not kind of scratch your itch if you're into the series. Helldivers is another impressive platinum to have. It's not especially difficult, but it is very long-winded. It takes between 50 and 100 hours, maybe even more. But apparently, I looked at the trophy guide, and this, it says something about a AFK method. that you can use to kind of cut down on that time. So it'd be interesting to hear, you know, how Lucas approached this platinum. I know it can take a lot longer depending on how you do approach it, if you're playing it completely legitimately.
So what are you going to do, interview the guy, or just keep wondering things about this guy?
He approaches his games, but he did pretty well to get it in 2 months and 2 weeks. This War of Mine, when was this free? This was free last year, so he's obviously bought this. And I think he does tend to sort of
gravitate so technical towards
the darker games, you know, the kind of the ones with quite mature themes. There was a game recently that may show up on his list in a moment. I can't remember if it's there or not, but it's called The Darkest Dungeon. And that's a game with a very dark theme, you know, it's all about kind of stress and reacting to fear and everything like that. It's a very clever concept, and I know he was very interested in it, and I think when he played it, it didn't really live up to his expectations, if I remember correctly. I know he left some comments on it on the channel. But he does tend to sort of gravitate towards these darker games. Obviously, there are some lighter ones like Lego Batman 2. But, you know, a lot of these games are quite dark themes. So we're sensing a kind of pattern here with Lucas.
All right.
He's a mass murderer.
All right.
We've got another quite dark game, but absolutely awesome game, is The Last of Us Remastered. And I'm actually quite jealous that he got to play this for the first time on PS4. Obviously, it's still awesome on PS3. It's an unbelievable game. But if the first time you play it is on the most recent version, which is 60 frames per second and just looks amazing, plays amazing, then that's even better. And he's got all the trophies, so he's done the DLC, which is great as well. He's played the online. I don't think he's the kind of player who particularly enjoys online trophies. In fact, this may be the only game in his list, apart from possibly GTA 5. But these Borderlands? Are some of the only games that actually have, you know, online trophies. So I think Borderlands are online. I don't think he online. Particularly enjoys them.
Well, XCOM, I'm pretty sure XCOM has online.
Like
Helldivers have online, do they?
Most of you don't. But yeah, I think The Last of Us is online is one of those online modes that even people who hate multiplayer might well enjoy, because it ties in so well with the single player. You know, when it comes to the gameplay style, you have to approach it in a very stealthy, very sort of methodical way, just like you do when you're playing through the campaign. He's got GTA 5 here, which he's obviously had on the go while playing a lot of these other games. It took him just over a year. That's another impressive one. Very long platinum and long 100% with the DLC as well. Nah. Dying Light, he's got a few more trophies for. This is a bit of a
sleeper. Oh my god, he clicked on the game for once.
One of those games that did quite
well. He's actually looking at a fucking list now.
You know, probably deserved a bit more praise than it got. I really enjoyed it. There's something new here, by the way. Some of you may not have noticed on psnprofiles.com. When you hover over one of these trophies, it changes the percentage. And this is really cool, actually. And what they've done is they've added in the PSN rarity. So as many of you will know, when you come onto this site, the percentage that you're seeing is basically the percentage of people that are on the site that have earned the trophy. Now, when you go on the PlayStation itself, on the PS4, and you look at your trophies, you can look at the rarity there, and it'll be a completely different percentage, because that takes into account everyone who's played the game. So when you look at this, the percentages are going to be very, very different. You've got here sort of 41%, and then it changes to 25%, 18% goes down to 3%. So basically, you know, this is a good example, actually. Italian Plumber, this is a trophy that you wouldn't automatically do, usually. You're using a particular skill and a particular weapon to get a kill.
Okay, we from, get it. You know, it's a fucking penny-ass trophy.
For the most part, you'd need to know that this was a trophy to work for it. So when you look at
it's one of those hard trophies. Yeah, okay, he got it. PSN, cool.
It's only 3.9%, because that probably represents the kind of percentage of people who played the game who are trophy.
Well, I'm not gonna bash on this. I'm not gonna bash on YORDAVIN, but like, something, why would you explain shit like that? Like, come on, man. Like, I know I haven't played Dying Light, but like, in all honesty, you don't really need to talk about this.
The hunters, along with a few people who might have accidentally got the trophy without trying. Then when you change it to just people who are on PSN profiles, that means that the majority of people here are obviously trophy hunters, so the percentage goes right up, because it's the kind of trophy that only trophy hunters are really aiming for, and a lot of people who just play games for fun and don't really care about the trophies might not earn this. So this is actually really handy, because when we do like reviews of trophies and when we do the trophy update each week,
oh,
you
no.
can change the setting at the top.
Wait.
You can change it. Where is it?
Oh my god.
Yeah, here. So you can put it in rarity on PSN. So PSN profiles or PSN.
Dude, why do you gotta explain all this bullshit, when man? Looking
at trophy sets and trying to figure out how difficult they are.
Oh, look at that. The platinum's a fucking ultra rare.
The PlayStation itself.
Collectibles so ultra rare.
Side comment. Doesn't really relate to the
beat the game. Wait, clear. I don't know what that is. Ultra rare.
It might be a bit confusing at
first.
Ultra rare. So used to using the PSN profiles rarity that when you look at these sort of new rarities, the PSN ones, and they're really low, you might think, wow, they're super hard. But obviously you have to bear in mind that the rarity we've been using up until this point is much higher. The percentages have been much higher because of the fact that we're just looking at a collection of trophy hunters, you know, how many people that are members of this site have actually had the trophy. Anyway, I'm totally rambling on now, guys. I apologize about that.
You ramble too fucking long.
Trophies. Oh, he's done. Yeah, this kind of backs up my theory that he's not that into online trophies because he's done the single player DLC, which is the following. This is actually something I need to find
time
for.
Okay, we see
that.
I've
not done myself yet. He hasn't done. Okay, so he basically hasn't done any of the online trophies or, well, I suppose these are single-player challenges, aren't they? But they're a real pain. I actually glitched these. I used the glitch and put up a video about it on my channel, which probably doesn't work anymore. I'm guessing they've probably patched it. You might
good.
Be able to
I can do it for fucking legit, then.
It. But those were very difficult. All these trophies here are, let's have a look. Yeah, these are all related to the Bozak Horde, and that's basically almost like a raid. So you go in with a group of people and there's some trophies that involve unlocking different types of arrows, and that involves completing it in a certain time or with certain challenges finished. And it was actually really fun at the time, but it's the kind of fun that I don't want to do again, you know? It's one of those I felt a real sense of accomplishment with. I found quite difficult, but enjoyed it because I really poured myself into learning it and getting good at the at the Bozak Horde. Yeah, that was fun.
Okay.
But let's sort of head back. I don't know why I scrolled up there. Let's go back to his list and carry on going up through his games.
Oh my god.
Okay, so we've got Journey here, which is another easy 100%. As he mentioned, he only plays easy games if they're fun. And I'm sure he enjoyed this because I absolutely loved it. It's just one of those magical experiences that if you're in the right mood for it, it can really leave a lasting memory sort of imprinted in your brain. It's very, very simple, but just the way they approach the multiplayer aspect of it, the fact that you can stumble across people, you don't know who they are. They're almost like NPCs in the game, but you know that they're being controlled by other people around the world. You don't know what their name is. I think you can go to your recently met players in your friends list and it might come up there, but it doesn't have a name above the head. But you know, you can't talk to them, you can't communicate via chat, you know, on a headset or anything like that. But you do have literally one button you can use as a kind of signal, and you have to try and interpret what the other person's saying. He's trying to sort of get you to go to where he is, or maybe asking for help or something. It's literally just one button. It lets out like a bong, and it's really weird, but it's really clever. And I don't know, there's just something about it. You feel like a connection with that person, that complete stranger who you're never going to meet in real life, you're never going to know their name or anything. And I actually played it with a friend of mine. We took a while sort of trying to get put into a game together because you can only have two people together at one time. And if one of you carries on into the next level or the next area, then they leave the other person behind and then they're split up. And, you know, they might stumble across someone else. It's like an organic online experience, basically. But I was able to meet up with a buddy of mine and we played through a few sections, but then we lost each other somehow. I think if you get too far ahead in the same area, even if you don't move on to the next area, it can kind of separate you. But then later on, it was so weird. We were actually chatting on the headset at the time, you know, via a party, because we were, you know,
stories about him. Okay.
And later on, we I bumped into someone else and he bumped into someone, and because it happened so close together, you know, we both bumped into someone at the same time, basically. We were trying to figure out, we were like, have we met each other again? And obviously we did some movements and kind of played around to sort of signal to each other.
One of those
and
fucking
we had found
TV
each other.
Moments. Like, where you see
shit
pure like that.
Luck. It was when the game first came out, so there was like thousands, hundreds of thousands of people playing it. And the fact that we stumbled into each other again was just amazing. Just that experience, that way that they handle the online is just so clever, and it just, I don't know, there's something about it. It's like the best simple game that I've played because there's really nothing to it, but it's just so much fun. The ending of it is awesome as well, actually. I was just remembering, you sort of start climbing a mountain because the whole thing is about reaching a mountain.
God. Wait, why are you spoiling the game, man?
Snowy, and the scarf that you've had that's given you the, your power all the way through the
game. Oh, fuck no, this nigga's spoiling the fucking game.
That starts sort of breaking away and you're losing your power and you're moving really slow. You get slower and slower because you're practically freezing.
Well, thanks a lot, man. Spoil it for me, man.
Because you now expected to happen. Shit. Your scarf by being close to it.
You know, honestly, I don't give a fuck about spoilers, but like, why would you do that for your own video? Like, you don't fucking talk about the ending unless it's stupid.
Another player, we are both stood next to each other, real huddled together, trying to climb this mountain, trying to stay out of the cold and get into shelter and stuff. And then, you know, that's just such a powerful experience. It actually left us speechless. We weren't even talking on the chat. And then when we reach the top of the mountain, you finally break through, you know, through the clouds, and you get back into the sun and you get all your powers back and it's all bright and cheerful and everything. And it's just such a powerful moment where you're just flying through. You've got all these pads that allow you to keep flying up through the mountain.
Beat the game, you're like, cool.
Everything rises. It's just, oh, it's amazing. You can tell I love it. And I'd love to hear if Lucas enjoyed it as much as me. But for me, that's one of the most standout experiences in gaming.
Yeah, spoiling the game is your standout experience.
And just the way things played out was just amazing. I'd love to hear from you as well about Nom Nom Galaxy, Lucas, because this is one of the games that almost made it onto my easiest free platinums list, because I looked at the trophy guide and a lot of people have given it a low rating on the difficulty thread, but it's got a very low completion percentage. If we have a look at it, you'll see
what the fuck?
1.3% on psnprofiles.com, 0.1% on PSN. So that's insane. I mean, for a game to have 1.3% on this website, that means it's like among the super, super rare platinums on PS4. Now, obviously, the fact that it's been free does contribute towards that because, you know, a lot of people play these free games, they try them out, and then they don't like them. I think this is the kind of game that a lot of people didn't enjoy. So it might well be that, you know, so many people tried it because it was free. Most of those people didn't enjoy it, so they didn't stick with it for the platinum. And that's probably led to the low percentage, but it's still very, very low, even taking that into account.
Making assumptions like crazy, like, come on.
So I'd love to hear from you, Lucas, as to whether you found this easy or not, because some people say it is, other people say it takes a bit of getting used to, but once you are used to it, you know, it's fairly straightforward. It's a real anomaly, this one. It confuses me every time I see it. Maybe I should just try it out myself. It's nice being able to spend a bit more time with these games. I mentioned to Lucas when he said, you know, is my account big enough to have a review? Absolutely, you know, obviously with the bigger accounts, I feel a bit rushed and we're scrolling through the games a lot quicker.
So your account's big enough for me to watch this, dude.
So if any of you who are thinking you'd love to have a review on your account, but you feel like it's a bit small or whatever, don't feel like that, you know. I actually enjoy reviewing these smaller accounts.
So this list is actually really good. I'm not gonna lie, though.
It'd be interesting to see which of the trophies on Little Big Planet he hasn't earned.
Okay, dude. Well, hold on. You do Little Big Planet, but not Lord of the Rings Conquest or PlayStation Home. Come on, man.
Find ones that involve maybe getting a lot of likes or something. Oh, no. Collect all the prize bubbles on the story levels. That, I think, is one of the slightly tougher trophies. I think they were a bit harder on Little Big Planet 2.
That too, obviously.
The third one is a bit easier.
That's hard.
Story levels without dying, with the exception of those levels that only end when you die. And then DLC. Okay, so he has done...
What do you think the prize bubbles?
Were there trophies for getting a lot of likes?
I think I have that.
Yeah, the levels you have published were hearted by 50 or more people, and were hearted by 30 or more people. I wonder if he's done that legitimately. I think he probably has. He probably just spent some time creating stuff and earning those likes or those hearts.
I think isn't that what you're supposed to do?
Planet 2, I think maybe the requirements are higher. And I know in Mod Nation Races as well, the requirements for that are ridiculous. You have to create tons of stuff, and you have to have loads of people liking them. But that seems fairly reasonable. If you make something worthwhile, then you're going to get enough people liking you, or you can kind of pair up with people. Although I get the feeling that you probably didn't boost it. Although you can do, obviously, you can meet up.
Hey, why is it so important, though?
And you can all heart each other and get that trophy out of the way.
What the fuck is that so important to you?
Have a look here. He's got Demon Souls, and this has got missing timestamps as well.
Oh my god!
No
assumptions.
Maybe because they're longer, tougher platinums. This is especially. Maybe he's kind of thought to himself, because he has got into trophies, I wonder if he played this on a blank account and didn't sort of set up the time and day on it. I'd be interested in hearing about that. Or possibly...
Why do you care about that so much?
Actually, when it says with missing timestamps, I wonder if, yeah.
Bro, if I'm going to talk about trophies, man, why am I going to talk about the dates and all that shit, man? I'm talking about, oh, fucking WWE 13, fucking King of the Hills, the fucking pain-ass trophy. Like, come on, dude.
Okay, I think probably what's happened here is that he maybe started playing this back when he first opened the account, when he was playing New Vegas, but it's further up the list because he's gone back and finished it more recently. Obviously, you'll notice here that although he does have the PS4, he is still playing some PS3 games, which is cool. Obviously, I think most of them are games that he's going back and finishing to get the trophies for. His Darkest Dungeon that I mentioned earlier, this is a very interesting game. It's an RPG, but 2D, you know, you've got a party, but you're all kind of in a row. So
that's actually really good.
For your characters to be affects their stats and everything, but it also has an impact on the effect that the enemies have on them, because if they're right at the front of the row for too long, then they're sort of overcome by fear, and they have all these different status effects that come from being stressed, and they can go mad, and I think they can turn against your own teammates. You have to kind of go into these dungeons, and then when you come out, you go to a town, you have to give people a rest,
bruh,
you have to kind of maybe...
Alright, my fault. I had to dap up my friend real quick. So, where the fuck were we?
You're all kind of in a row, so the order in which you choose for your characters to be affects their stats and everything, but it also has an impact on the effect that the enemies have on them, because if they're right at the front of the row for too long, then they're sort of overcome by fear, and they have all these different status effects that come from being stressed, and they can go mad, and I think they can turn against your own teammates. You have to kind of go into these dungeons, and then when you come out, you go to a town.
Just let them know it's a hard-ass fucking game.
Give them some treatment and some therapy and stuff. But if you take them too far, then they're unusable because they just go insane, literally. Batman Arkham City doesn't have a Platinum 4, but this is more recent now. We're getting up to sort of the end of last year. And so I think, you know, these first few trophies in the game, he probably earned back in 2013 before he'd set up his account properly. And now he's gone back more recently. He's been playing it throughout last year, on and off. Maybe he's not having as much fun with it because he's sort of playing it for a little bit, maybe a couple of days there in April. And then again,
so technical with this shit, man.
The order in which they were earned, but it looks as though he did sort of go back in October and November trying to finish things off. He's still got some of the challenges to do, basically, and
bro,
also New Game
just
Plus.
Say,
so
tell him to get it done.
A case of time, and some of the challenges can be quite tricky. That will
who
ultimately
cares about
result
that?
In his sort of 100% trophy there, Perfect Night Day 2.
I swear to God, it's like he's trying to embarrass him or something, because this is ridiculous.
With this being more recent, it could well be that he's sort of in the middle of trying to finish that one off.
Okay.
We've got Red Dead Redemption here. We're going to have a look at this.
It's like, oh, the reason why he doesn't have that platinum is because, like, he doesn't have that trophy, so, you know, you can't do it at all. I'm like, okay, dude.
Because this is one of those games that is very difficult to complete now based on the fact that the online was hacked. Now, this is a huge game. 734,000 people played on here, making it among the more popular games, you know, on the site. The online stuff here, he's got the platinum, so he's done all the online required for the platinum, and he did that back in 2014. In fact, the platinum itself took him, if we put them in order of, let's see, order of date, where's date? There we go.
No, why are you technical, man?
He started playing it in January 2014.
Okay.
Sort of midway through, and he finished it. Is that right? Hang on. Surely he...
Bruh!
Oh, sorry, I'm getting confused. I was like, January? Why has it gone back to January? That's because it's 2017.
Hold on,
sorry,
go scroll up real quick.
Okay,
scroll
so let's
real quick.
Go to the Platinum. There's the Platinum. 2nd of March. So that's only a month and a half. That's pretty good going because it's a big game, and doing all the online can be a bit tricky.
Go up.
Now, since
go up.
Then, in fact, I think it was sometime in 2014, probably a few months after he finished the plat, some hackers hacked the game, hacked the online portion, and Rockstar have never really sorted it out properly. So when you play it now, sometimes you'll notice loads of civilians lying on the floor. And what the hackers have done is they've put these civilians around that you can shoot to kill, and you'll get 1 XP, as you do when you kill civilians in the online portion. But that 1 XP will just repeat,
true.
Like, super, super fast.
Okay,
over
yeah,
over again,
I remember that.
A way of
I did that before.
Leveling up.
I was like, what the fuck is going on?
You know,
the
they
first
just
time,
sit there.
I remember that. The first time I did that shit, dude, I was like, what the fuck's going on? I'm getting leveled up like crazy. I'm like, okay, bet, since I don't have to do all this shit then.
They shoot a civilian, they sit there, and their XP just keeps climbing until they stop it. Now that sounds very useful for leveling up, but it's also introduced a whole load of new glitches and just problems with the online. It's very difficult to even get into a game with anyone. So although a lot of the online trophies are very easy to boost if you have enough people, it would be very difficult to do so now. That's probably why he does have some unfinished trophies here. In fact, we're going to take a look through some of these. They're all DLC related.
He played the game. Platinum or
anything. But the first ones are quite interesting. These are trophies that I struggled with when I played on my old account. Now I'm more accomplished gamer nowadays, and I'm more open to kind of trying new things, trying different approaches to trophies, and I think if I played it now, I probably would find a way of earning them. But back when I tried it several years ago, I found the advanced co-op missions very, very difficult. Obviously, I didn't try them. I gave them a couple of attempts, and then I was like, you know what, let's just leave this for now and carry on with the other trophies. And then I never actually got round to going back to them. But I'd love to hear from anyone who did earn gold medals on all the advanced co-op missions. I'd love to hear how you did it, because whenever I play it, to be fair, it was with random, so we didn't have a strategy, we didn't plan our approach or anything, but it still seems very, very difficult. And I think, you know, maybe completing them would be okay if you were playing very carefully, but I don't think that would result in a gold medal. So I've always been confused as to whether these are a bit broken, maybe a bit too difficult. Like I say, if I tried it now, it might surprise me, and I might think, what was my problem? You know, I might just breeze through them. But I don't think that would be the case. He's got here, achieve a kill chain of 10 or more in any advanced co-op mission. That's actually not too bad. There is a mission where you start high up on a cliff and you're overlooking one of the sort of pens that's holding in all the cows. It's the mission where you've got to lead the cows back to town. And if you do that one, you can actually shoot 10 from quite a long distance away. You can just sort of stay up on the cliff and kill 10 nice and quickly. Use maybe a sniper rifle for it. So if you were thinking of trying to go back, because I have noticed that, you know, his most recent trophies have been in 2017. So yeah, it looks as though he might be kind of going back to try and 100% this. I'm not sure how well he'll get on with the advanced co-op missions, but that trophy there, like I mentioned, you can do that one quite easily. Come back from a 2-0 deficit and win a hold your own game. That's super easy. Literally just get one boosting partner. They grab two bags and score, and then you grab three and win it. Kill three or more players in a standoff or showdown.
These are fucking boosters. Oh, the fucking poker ace. He didn't even get that one.
To be able to kill three people before any of them kill you is a bit.
Poker ace gonna fucking kick his ass, dude. If
you
have four boosters,
then you just have them stand still.
Oh my god.
And during that sort of initial
intro
phase to a match where you're kind of all facing each other and you've got to try and shoot the other team or the other players.
I want to hear you talk about
this. You can just have them stand still and just take them all down. I hope you guys don't mind me giving out some advice on this. It may help some of you who are working on this as well. But I did notice that, like I mentioned, this may be a game that he's trying to get finished off. So I figured
That's a fucking difficult one.
Double capture three times in a single gold rush map. I think you need a certain number of players for this because you don't have two bags spawn. If there's only two of you, I think it needs three or possibly four. So, you know, if you've got enough players and two bags spawn, you can just pick them both up and score. And that's super easy. Full multiplayer poker game. This is one of the trophies I never earned when I was playing this on my old account because you need, I think, six people and I just couldn't be bothered getting the boosting group together. But if you did have enough people, it would take a while to get through because you need to set everything up and then you need to do that for each player because obviously you're going to want to boost for everyone else as well. You're not likely to find five people who just want to help you and don't want the trophy themselves. This one here in a van down the river. Literally, you just keep playing. Basically, you go into a multiplayer poker game and keep playing. Don't ever sort of fold or anything. You just need.
I don't care about that, but that poker ace trophy, dude. Fuck that trophy.
To keep going, so that eventually you'll happen to win on the last card. It's pure luck, pure RNG on that one. This one in a single multiplayer lies dice game, successfully make a spot on call. Obviously very easy if you can communicate with the person you're playing with.
I'm sorry, but in the van down by the river, I think I probably got that like randomly. I don't remember.
They can tell you.
I don't even know if I got the DLC. I think I do have all the DLC other than the nightmare stuff. I think I have everything complete. I just need to platinum the game now.
What they've got 100% and everything. Win with only one dice left. Again, you just literally let yourself lose all your dice and then have your partner let you win all the rest of the rounds to make sure that that you get the trophy.
I'm talking about every single fucking trophy in the DLC.
Again, you know, self-explanatory, same with this one here. Round defense, do not allow the attacking team to capture any of their objectives. This is quite a funny trophy. When I boosted this, it's literally a case of everyone just puts their controller down and lets the game play out. Triple kill, again, you need four players for that. You can set everything up so it's one versus three. Oh, the
fucking posse points.
In fact, no, you might need God. Two versus three.
I forgot about that trophy.
It might not let you do
one versus three. Wait, no, it'll say eight posse, dude. That's the one I'm bitching about.
This is an interesting one. Gaining 50,000 posse points in a single free roam session. I don't remember that. Now, that can take a while. You can be doing hideouts and stuff and getting points in whatever way you can.
Oh, okay.
It's quite annoying, though, because you can lose connection and then your posse points are lost because you're not in the posse anymore. But if you join a posse that already has 50,000 points,
fucking kingpin, then it pops automatically. That's right, I forgot about that trophy,
dude. So if there's a big posse, you know, everyone in the posse is contributing towards the point total. If they've already got like 30,000 or something, you can join in and keep working on those points and hopefully pop it a lot quicker. Make it to wave 15 and undead overrun. This isn't too bad if you've got decent players with you. And again, this one requires 9 boosters. I think I did do this one at one point.
Fuck that trophy.
It's a real pain to set up because obviously everyone needs to earn it. It just takes time and organization, and a lot of people just mess around when they're boosting. So that was a real pain. But yeah, that's just some advice for you, Lucas, if you were trying to get that one finished off. Hopefully that's helpful, maybe helpful to some of the rest of you as well. I know Red Dead Redemption is one of those games that a lot of people have on their list that they've got the platinum for, but they haven't necessarily finished the DLC. So hopefully some others amongst you might find that useful. Fallout 4 here, we've kind of already spoken about this. Great game. A lot of people do prefer Fallout 3 New Vegas, which I agree with. Fallout 3 is still my favorite. But, you know, I was so hyped for this game and it didn't disappoint me. I really loved it. And it's one of the only games recently that I've actually gone back into and played after earning all the trophies. Although I haven't earned the DLC yet, or, you know, not all the DLC. There's a couple that I need to finish off. You know, I was quite happy to go in and start a brand new character. I wasn't earning trophies, but I was just playing. I was streaming it as well on Twitch.
It's all about this guy, not you, man. Come on.
Stream, which I'll speak about more maybe over the weekend. But possibly every Tuesday at the same time as I stream.
Okay, on, you know, all right, Tuesday we get it. Gone. You say it in like every single fucking video that I don't even have to watch. You know, I saw the 10K sub thing and like, oh my God, what the fuck, dude?
Back into. I know a lot of my Twitch followers were following me because of my Fallout 4 stream. So that could be interesting. Dragon Age 2 here, he's carried on with the franchise that he obviously enjoys. We've got Tropico 5. This is the game I'd like to play at some point. I do like the idea of these Tropico games.
So okay, but he didn't have Dragon Age Inquisition, so why didn't you say that?
Really spent any time with them. It was free recently, although the DLC was quite expensive. But it was on sale, so I did pick up the DLC, and I might be able to 100% that Witcher at some 3, point. Though. I can't really speak much about the game because I haven't played it. The Witcher 3, another big, long RPG, obviously. You know, relatively tricky as well. It's not super easy like some RPGs are. So props to him for that. Took him 1 year and 5 months, so he's really poured his time into that and probably got everything out of it. I know he really enjoys these types of games. LetterQuest Remastered is a game that, you know, I see around a lot. I see the name all over the place, mostly because I often search for root letter. You know, I have done for some of the videos I've made. That's one of the easy Japanese games that's actually quite enjoyable.
God damn it, dude. But fucking visual novel like shit.
Root is actually a sign rather than a word. I just search for the word letter and it always comes up with LetterQuest. And I've kind of always wondered what it was and never had a chance to check it out. But because of this review, I sort of took a look at some gameplay on YouTube. And it actually looks like the kind of game that would really appeal to me. You see, one of my guilty pleasures is Scrabble, which is really easy, but I really enjoy it. I play it every
week. Man, if you never played it before, why are you talking about it?
Week with my nan. My nan comes round to visit on Sundays, and I'm always having to kind of leave.
First of all, it's not about you. It's about this guy. Why are you talking about yourself in LetterQuest, knowing your story behind it, man? Come on.
The table occasionally to run upstairs and check the progress of the, you know, the trophy update upload. And, you know, fill in the title and everything. Anyway, I play that every Sunday with my nan. She really loves it. But I also used to play quite regularly with a friend of mine who would always have a go at me if I brought up Scrabble around other people because it is quite nerdy. But we really loved it. And we were both very, very good at it. Not to play my own trumpet, but we were both good with words.
Oh, shit. I forgot about Red Dead.
I think it's the kind of board game that I think gamers do well with because we're used to the kind of thought pattern, being able to see all the eventualities, being able to sort of calculate things back, in our head.
It's too late.
And I don't know. I just really enjoy it. And when I watch the video, it looks like that kind of game. You know, you get a group of letters and you have to use those letters to make a word. The better the word and the longer it is, the more damage you do to the enemies that you're facing. And I might pick this up based on, you know, the video that I watched. Seems like my kind of thing. In fact, I say pick it up. I think it was free, wasn't it, on PlayStation Plus. here's the other Telltale's game that he's played. It kind of makes sense to me that he's played The Walking Dead and Game of Thrones and not any of the others. Because like I said, he seems to be into his sort of darker themed games. God. And so, you know, Game of Thrones and The Walking Dead kind of fit in with that preference, I suppose. Child of Light, this is really good. It doesn't have a platinum, but I recommend it. And it's got, I think it's got 3 stacking trophy sets. And if you buy it, I believe it's cross-buy, so you get the PS4, PS3, and Vita version. At least I bought a sort of hard copy of it. I bought a box with some collectible stuff in, and it gave you the code. So it was still digital, but you had a box, and I think the code to all 3. So it's probably the same if you buy it off the store. So you can sort of 100% this game 3 times and earn more trophies from it. It's just really enjoyable. It's quite different. You know, it's a 2D RPG where you're controlling the girl, but you're also controlling a light that flies around, and you can use the light to collect, grab collectibles that are out of your reach, and to pull switches, and also to charge you up, you know, charge your special attack when you're in battle. Kind of like a turn-based battle system, but with a twist, and I can't remember exactly how it works, so I won't go into details, but it's really quite interesting, and it's quite a unique system. Oh, you know what, I do remember, it has kind of come back to me. Each of the enemies, as well as yourself, has a bar that fills up, and when it's filled up, you can take a turn. Mm-hmm. But it's all about trying to time your turns so that you can actually use the light that flies around to slow down the enemy's charge. So you have to sort of strategically choose which enemy you want to slow down to kind of change the order in which the attacks are going to happen. It's really cool, and I think I need to go back and play that again on one of the other consoles just to experience it again, because it was a lot of fun. No Man's Sky here looks to be the game that he's in the middle of playing now. In fact, he's played that today, 17th of March. So as I'm recording this, maybe he's literally on No Man's Sky as we speak. It looks like he's working on the DLC, which I haven't played myself yet. But I do need to get around to doing that at some point. They've actually kind of really overhauled the game and improved it a lot, because there was a lot of backlash. You know, people were complaining about how simple everything was, how there wasn't really much to do in the game. So they've pretty much redone everything. They spent a long time doing it. It was months. We didn't even really hear from Hello Games for a while. And I think that's because they were really knuckling down to try and sort their game out. They should have been a bit more communicative about it. But at least now they have come out with a patch.
Could have been more... Oh, true. No.
That has pretty much overhauled everything and turned it into a game that a lot of people are enjoying. And hopefully I'll be able to experience that when I do try the DLC. But yeah, so that seems to be what he's on right now. So, that is YORDAVIN's account, guys. I hope you don't mind me going into a lot more detail on some of the games sort of giving my opinions on...
It's way too much! A fucking hour!
A lot of advice on Red Dead Redemption. I hope that didn't bore those of you who have already done it or don't plan on doing it. But that's one of the things that these reviews should be all about, is like giving out advice on how to finish off games that haven't been completed. Obviously, the last 2 reviews I did were both very long, so I didn't really have a chance to do that. But it's nice to be able to focus on each game in more detail, like I said before. So I want to say...
If you're going to review... Trophy collection review. Okay, hold on a second. Trophy collection review. So if you're a trophy collection review... Why are you making assumptions? I don't understand this guy right now.
Thank you to Lucas for letting us review his account. He's got a very nice completion percentage here, so congratulations on that. Obviously, that's something that really gains an account a lot of respect. Some accounts are high level, and you know, people notice it off the back of that. Some accounts are lower level, but high completion rating, and maybe got a lot of impressive platinums on the account.
He has a lot of impressive platinums.
Him a long time to finish. So he's put a lot of time and effort into this account, and
I fuck with this list.
Well done, Lucas. Keep it up. And there we go. So next week we'll be covering one of our Patreon subscribers. I haven't had a look to see who it is yet, but like I mentioned at the start, please feel free to put your name down on the list, or you know, message me and ask me to do so. And hopefully, if I make this a regular feature, then I'll be able to get through all our patrons and then move on to you guys. and make sure it's fair for everyone. But it is, you know, first come, first served, just to make sure that it is fair and no one's waiting around for like years for their review. But hopefully you're enjoying watching them as well. It's quite nice to be able to review accounts belonging to people that are very active on the channel, because you guys probably feel like you know them already. You read a lot of comments from them. You maybe converse with them in the comment section. So hopefully that sort of adds an extra layer of interest to these.
I guarantee you when I upload this video, I'm going to get a fuckload of whatever you videos. Said. I forgot what you said.
Anyway, I'm going to go now, guys, because depending on how long this video takes to edit, I may record a second one today. But remember to tune in tomorrow, Saturday, for the 10,000 subscriber celebratory stream.
I saw that.
Just to clear up, because I wasn't aware that some states are on different times. I think it works, you know, some are on EST, some are on EDT. It's going to be at 7 p.m. GMT. That's 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. But if you're on daylight time, it's going to be 3 p.m. for you. So just bear that in mind. I know I probably confused a few people because I wasn't fully aware of that. But hopefully we'll catch you then. The Tuesday stream went really well. It was really enjoyable. We played a bit of Shadow of Mordor, and I'm thinking about making it a regular thing now. But tomorrow we're going to be looking through all my platinums and all my finished games and everything, just discussing them all. That's going to be a lot of fun. And I'll catch you then. So have a good one, guys, and I'll see you later. Cheers.
Look at that shit. Oh, sorry. Okay, I fuck with that though. But okay, so, well, the one thing I can say is that, like, you make too many assumptions. You need to stop doing that. And I see the way you review this is like you just look at the game and you talk about something, but then you just all of a sudden you start giving out a guide about Red Dead Redemption, and then you just what the hell? He didn't even check about the Lord of the Rings Conquest or PlayStation Home if he even get the online for it. I mean, I don't even think Home you can 100% anymore. But Conquest, he didn't even check that, and you rambled too fucking long. Like, bruh, you don't need to talk about all that. Just talk about how enjoyable it is, talk about how you love it and all that, but like, stop making assumptions, dude. Not only that, dude, you dedicate your fucking time to the dates. Like, bro, it's not that serious. It is really not that serious. If you want to talk about a story about whatever trophy you have, that's fine, but like, bro, why you gotta look at the dates and say, oh, he played that game first, so what about that trophy? Like, what the hell, man? But I really enjoyed the video, and I kind of like what you're doing, so it kind of makes me, you know, kind of quiet myself out so you can do all the work and I don't have to do all this shit. But like, basically I'm saying, if he's gonna do this every week, you might as well just tune into that guy, because I'm gonna do it every month. Unless I get support, then I'll do more. So, you know, support me. But I really enjoyed the video. I just hope you don't really get mad at me. I mean, any reaction that you just saw earlier, please just try to fix yourself a little bit, please. YORDAVIN, I fuck with your list. Or Lucas, if you want me to call you that, I'm calling you YORDAVIN, that's too personal. I fuck with your list. I like that shit, man. RPGs, you're a fucking RPG maniac. I fuck with it. And that's my first ever reaction video, so I guess I hope you guys enjoy it. I just hope no people bash on me on this shit. I mean, this is my personal opinion. My personal opinion. I'm just being me, dude. I'm just being myself. So if you want to take it seriously, go ahead. I really don't give a shit if it gets like fuckload of dislikes. But other than that, stay tuned for the next reaction video. You know, I might make one more. Just one more, and that's it. As you're listening to the best trophy hunter ever. Period.